Good morning, everybody. I am just so pleased, honored to be here today, this morning, and welcome Marc Morial to Goldman Sachs. Marc is the president and chief executive officer of the National Urban League, and he's here for a very important discussion, what we hope to be a dialogue on race relations in the United States. The dialogue on race, well, we know what's out there. Race as an issue, an opportunity is out there, and it's really surfaced to a national level with a real sense of urgency. But I would suggest, and I'd be interested as we start our conversation with Marc, it's an issue, but is there a dialogue? Is there a dialogue on race in the United States, and are we having that dialogue internally? Well, I'm thrilled today to say that we have begun a dialogue on race and race relations in the U.S. today. It's pretty complicated. And why don't we start with, Marc, a conversation around you. I think that my colleagues would be really interested to hear about you, your background as an entrepreneur, lawyer, professor, mayor, activist. Marc, who are you?
So my early life was defined by a ditch. And the reason why it was defined by the ditch is because the ditch separated the neighborhood I grew up in called Pontchartrain Park from a neighborhood called Gentilly Woods. So Pontchartrain Park was all black, Gentilly Woods was all white, and it was divided by a ditch about the width of this middle section of the room. However, because the schools became integrated, we left Pontchartrain Park every day and walked three blocks into Gentilly Woods. And that ditch, to an extent, defined my early life because it was living in an all-African-American neighborhood and going to a school which was integrated even as we went in the early days. And so it was a clear sense of division because in those days, getting called the N-word or being once or twice chased home from school was not an unusual occurrence. It was just part of what you understood and certainly how you grew up.
What do your parents say to you when you come home having been chased and called the N-word? What conversation do they have with you as a young, impressionable mind such that you go back to school the next day and not...
My parents were civil rights warriors, and they were integrationists who absolutely believed they grew up in a segregated New Orleans, but were on the front lines of their life. My mother went to Boston University, actually, and was a classmate of Martin Luther King's. My father was the first African American to attend the LSU Law School in the 1950s, and they were very much into changing society. So they sort of counseled us that we had to be strong, that we had to be tough, that we had to withstand the heat. And it was more about that, being tough, being strong, and withstanding the heat, than getting mad or getting angry, but also to be certainly aware. And I say that because when it comes to race and racial issues, we all have our own life and perspective. So when I was growing up, I had black friends in the neighborhood, and I had black and white friends at school, right? So to a great extent, my upbringing put me in more than one world. It's the sense of duality, living in different worlds that didn't really connect with each other, was part of my upbringing and part of my life, and it may define the upbringing for some of you. So you get these navigation skills, and you get these skills of learning at a very young age that everybody isn't the same, and that people have a whole host of different perspectives. And it is something that has made me what I am today. We become adults, and we are limited in what we see, know, understand, and the people we have contact with. That's generally the way it is, right? And I'm not saying that's an awful thing, that's a bad thing.
It's reality.
The neighborhood, it's reality. So if you get to adulthood and your perspectives are baked in and you don't believe you're in a continuing transformation to learn about the differences in people. Look, I never saw a bagel in my life until I went to the University of Pennsylvania. I saw a bagel and a pretzel, and I said, why would anybody eat hard bread?
Now, are you serving bagels in the dining room of the National Urban League?
Yeah, now my kids are 9 and 12. They, I mean, they eat bagels like anything. And I mean, my son just got introduced to grits for the first time. He said, Daddy, I like that.
We'll explain to everyone what that is at another time.
You know, this is all sort of, you know, you also have this, you know, regional perspective. When it comes to race and understandings of race, there are regional differences in the country. You know, and they may operate below the surface, but they're regional differences in perspectives, you know, and attitudes. My marking point for it, my data point for it, is the Barack Obama election. So, Barack Obama carried a majority of the white vote in 12 states the first time, 10 states the second time. In no southern state, the old southern states, and I'm talking about really South Carolina, Georgia, Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, he barely broke double digits in the white vote. It's an interesting data point, right? And the reason why I raise the data point is because any discussion around race and race relations in this country, it needs to be grounded with a little understanding of what the numbers say. Little understanding of the data. And I'm not talking just about attitudinal data. That was an issue that struck me when I joined the National Urban League 12 years ago.
Now, Marc, can I just have you pause for a second there? Because you mentioned that your family was very involved in creating change through civil rights and organizations. The National Urban League is one of the most prominent 105 years of history of the National Urban League, creating a center of gravity to advocate for race and rights and access. And we're not talking about elaborate things. We're talking about right to vote. We're talking about right to go to school. We're talking about right to access to opportunities. Tell us a little bit about the National Urban League and why, after the decades of impact that you've made on a regional and then on a state level, you've decided to spend the time that you have in the Urban League.
So I'd like to look at the National Urban League. We are an historic civil rights organization. That term defines organizations whose mission was civil rights before the civil rights era of the 1960s. Go back to 1910. And as a civil rights historic civil rights organization, we're sui generis, one of a kind. And the reason why we're one of a kind is because one of the things we do is we do direct services programs. Right, and most civil rights organizations are activists, advocates, litigation focused exclusively. We do a direct services program. What does that mean? So we have after school programs for young people. We serve several hundred thousand young people in after school programs each and every year. We have job training and job placement programs. And we do this work through a network of 90 on-the-ground locations in urban communities that we call affiliates. We serve about 100,000 people a year when it comes to housing financial literacy. We serve about 12,000 businesses a year through a suite of, in effect, free consulting services called our entrepreneurship centers, and it's through that program that we work with Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Businesses program. Then we do legislative and public policy advocacy, right? So we're very active nationally within the Beltway, working on whether it's voting rights, whether it's expansion of healthcare, whether it's technology access issues, economic issues, inside the Beltway trying to affect public policy. And then we do a seminal piece of research every year called The State of Black America.
And that's where the data comes in.
That's where the data comes in. And so the data is interesting because I think the NGO sector traditionally has not been data-driven. And I've tried to bring that ethos, that ethic, that approach to the work we do. So we created with the old Wharton Econometrics operation. It's now called IHS. This seminal statistical index called the Equality Index. So we have an index where we compare the status of whites and blacks, and then whites and Latinos. So we compare everything from life expectancy, death rates due to AIDS, cardiovascular diseases, unemployment levels, graduation rates, college matriculation rates, business formation rates, 300 data sets. We publish it each and every year. What does it tell us? It tells us that the status of African Americans is about 71-72% of whites. Latinos about 75% of whites. And we track that data. We've been tracking it now for 10 years. It's glacially changed. The overall data index has glacially changed. And what's really, really dramatic is how we've done from time to time public opinion polls and compared what people believe or what they think to the data. And sometimes that's where the tension in American life comes in. That you'll have some people who think the playing field's level, economic opportunity is abundant, and then you have some people say, you know, things are worse now than they were in the 1950s and the 1960s, right? So you get a large percentage of people who believe one of those two extremes in the situation. Both of them are fundamentally wrong, right? They're both wrong. It is better than it was in the 1950s and the 1960s, but equal opportunity is not flowing from every fountain in American life. And I think intelligent people, people in leadership positions, right? People who are tasked with leading institutions, business institutions, governmental institutions, civic institutions, faith institutions, should make it their business to educate themselves on the facts and the data. And then from there have the conversation.
When we look back now at the civil rights movement, the watch on Washington, we're reminded of what went on with the movie Selma. You know, we look back in that and go, those were real moments that were turning points in the dialogue around race. Are we living that moment right now in looking at what's gone on in Ferguson and Staten Island? Or is it tough to say? You mentioned earlier something about Martin Luther King. Can you share that?
Yeah, so it's very interesting. Martin Luther King is certainly this iconic figure who's generally accepted and generally, 50 years later, a popular figure in American life. Gallup did a poll in 1963 around the time of the March on Washington, and Martin Luther King had a disapproval rating of 70 to 80% with white Americans and 40% with black Americans. Martin Luther King was very, to some extent, controversial in his times. And he was why was he controversial with certain African Americans? Because prior to Martin Luther King bringing the tactics of Gandhi, which were non-violent resistance and disobedience to laws that were unjust, immoral, and unfair, the civil rights movement had been dominated in the 30s, the 40s, and into the 50s by lawyers and advocates who believed the way to bring about change was by using the Constitution and the courts. And by the time the mid-50s had come, there had been some success in that regard. There had been the Brown versus the Board of Education decision, which was a landmark, earth-shattering, transformative decision in the Supreme Court. So many of the lawyers and people who were legal advocates saw King as a disruptor, you know, as an irritant, as someone who was engaging in risky strategies that were going to do nothing other than promote a backlash. Because as you think about today, and that's really the issue. What about today? You know, what about now? I would say to you that one of the things that we have to always be cognizant of now is how the country is changing demographically. What struck me about Ferguson, which was interesting, is this is a small community of 21,000 people that has moved from being 70% white in 1990 to being 70% African American by the time 2010 came. That's had a rapid demographic transformation, and the governmental structures never changed, you know, as the population changed in that community. And so you've got that demographic change taking place, but the institutions of service, which is what government is, and the institutions of leadership have not made that evolution as that community has certainly evolved. So we are engaging in a transformation demographically, which means that issues of equity, fairness, and justice become far more essential, I believe, to American economic competitiveness, to the sustainability of institutions, to our ability to have a nation which where we have a sense of civic understanding and peace. And that is a dynamic of now that was not necessarily, in the 60s, they were not concerned about demographic shifts, demographic transformations.
Clearly, from my perspective, and I'll assume from everyone else's perspective here, if we do not have diversity at every level of the firm, we're not there yet, but just the math, let's go to the data, as you just described, if in 2019 we don't start to see a significant move in the demographic mix, I would just go so far to say that we're leaving some of the best and the brightest behind. But in the same way that we felt very strongly that we needed to be at the front of the conversation on LGBT rights, why do we need to be in the dialogue on race?
If you pride yourself on being a leading institution, right? A leading institution, and an institution didn't just show up last week and is looking to be acquired next week, but a leading institution in American life, then focusing on compelling issues of the times, like getting diversity and inclusion right, is part of your DNA, part of your responsibility, part of your obligation. If the demographics of the country are changing, and the workforce of America is going to be different in 2020, 2025, 2030, just getting the best talent, you know, requires a wider net. There's reputational issues associated with having a clear understanding and a respect for diversity, for inclusion, and certainly for differences. There's a lot of reasons. I think at the end of the day, more than anything, the driver of it is economics. In an age of globalization, public opinion counts because public opinion can affect the company's reputation. It can affect how its own frontline employees who are working every day believe. People who work for a company want to believe that a company stands for the right things, that the company is responsive to those things that are important to me. And that is indeed a challenge with a changing, you know, workforce. So yes, it's critical. You know, indeed, it's important, and I think it's essential.
We are thrilled to have you here. We appreciate the commitment that you've made to the country. We are all coming together amongst ourselves, and this will be the launch of what we know will be a more open dialogue that's more inclusive, that will make an impact, not just for Goldman, but for the economies that we serve in. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you all.